At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today. Hi, I'm John Mallos. Welcome to this live edition of Connect With Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV on this day. Glad you're with us. It's on the air off the presses a Monday morning, the day after the Warriors lost the NBA title at home. Unbelievable game. Anyway, we'll talk to our guest today, not about that, but about the weather. 436, Me TV, option 11, back in just a moment. And welcome back to the program here on Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. I'm John Mallos, of course, and it is Monday morning on the air off the presses. And our guest hasn't been here in quite some time. He'll talk about the weather. It will be heating up this week. There's no question about that. I'm afraid to ask how hot it's going to get, but I will. Anyway, a couple of programming notes. Tomorrow, Sam Shima is going to be here, gymnastics beat. You know, he's one business owner who had to move his business because of high-speed rail. He's already moved not too far away, so his business hasn't been all that disrupted. But on Wednesday, we're going to have a special guest, first-time guest, from the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, he'll talk about the religion, how it started, what they all do, and what it's all about. And then on Thursday, Peter Nazaridian. As if we need it, he'll be here. He's our resident therapist. Yes, we all need therapy here, including everybody in the room, from the corner way back there all the way to here. Anyway, and then Friday, the CHP man is going to be here. His name is Johnny Fisher. He hasn't been here in a while. He'll update us on a few things, including DUI, do not drive under the influence. So that is for the coming week. In the meantime, let's get right to our guest. And he is a second-time guest here on Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. So glad he is here. Let's roll the videotape, my friends, and I'll show you exactly what I am talking about. We will be talking about the weather, and here's a little bit of a hint. That's the control room right there at KMPH, Fox 26. It's a kind of a behind-the-scenes look at what they do on the 10 o'clock news, and there he is. Here's Kevin at the green wall. Anyway, Kevin Raymer is our guest today. He's been the KMPH AMS SEAL, I guess meteorologist you would call him, the head guy over there at the 10 o'clock news for many moons now. He's been there almost a decade. Can you believe that? 10 years has already gone by. Kevin does this Monday through Friday. He's standing in front of the green wall, and up comes that chroma key shot. You can see all of California in the background, including the Central Valley and, of course, Fresno. And Kevin does this Monday through Friday. He also has other duties at the station. He'll be here to talk about that. The weather, the National Weather Service was here not all that long ago, so we'll talk to him about that. Where do the local stations get their information from to give you the weather at home? How relevant is local weather these days? Because, you know, look, you got social media, you got the internet, you got Facebook, you got Twitter. Do you still watch local news to get the weather? You know, one time when I broke into the business, you know what the most popular part of the news program was back in the day? It was the weather segment. Is it still the most popular? Well, one of the most popular guys here in Fresno is our guy, Kevin Raymer. Live in our studio is Kevin Raymer from KMPH Fox 26 News. He is here to talk about the weather. He's here to talk about, you know, some new weather equipment that they just obtained over there at KMPH Fox 26. He'll take your phone calls at 436-ME-TV, option 11. Be polite, my friends, because you can't always get the forecast right. It's not an exact science. It's a forecast, okay? Anyway, the guy from the National Weather Service told me that. 436-ME-TV, option 11. Dr. Thomas Casagrande is our sponsor today. We're back in just a moment.
Frigidaire. It means the first electric refrigerator. The first compact electric range. Now, there's the Frigidaire Gallery Range with Symmetry Double Ovens. It's designed to cook multiple dishes at multiple temperatures, so you can prepare the entire meal at the same time. Frigidaire, over 90 years of legendary innovation.
See the full line of Frigidaire appliances at Ventura TV Electronics and Appliances.
At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today.
Back here in the program, Thomas Casagrande, our sponsor today here on Connect With Me. Kevin Raymer, the guest from KMPH, Fox 26.
Did I get that right? Did you say I had been there almost 10 years already?
Yeah, that's what you told me.
Wow.
10 years, a decade?
I'm doing the math here. Yeah, 10 years in November. Time flies when you're having fun.
Why, right? Are you still having fun?
Oh, of course. Trying to deal with this heat wave we're about to undergo.
So what's new over there at the old barnyard that to work at?
A lot. Yeah, you were there back in the day, huh?
Yeah, I was there, 10 or 11 years?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You had already moved on before I moved in.
Yeah.
I guess. But
yeah. I made the place for you. I said this is where Raymer's moving in.
You set up all the furniture and you
set up the furniture. Okay, I'm out of here. Here's Kevin's new spot.
Well, you did a good job. Yeah. What's new? We just the station Sinclair Broadcasting, which owns KMPH, just invested recently in top of the line, state of the art weather equipment, weather graphics computers to build the weather maps, and just a state-of-the-art radar storm tracking system.
How does it track through? I mean, obviously through radar, right? But what makes it state-of-the-art, Kevin? I mean, is it too technical for me to understand?
It's kind of an integration of Doppler radar, but with all the bells and whistles, so we can not only just show you with a live scan where the rain is falling or thunderstorm
and where the clouds are and all that.
Well, it shows we have satellite pictures too, but the radar specifically hones in on like rain and thunderstorms.
Oh,
but we can actually show the motion of them, show which direction they're moving. We have storm tracker capabilities, so we can tell you how fast the storm is moving, what communities it'll be affected at what time. Doing an automated storm track, we can tell how much hail's in the storm. We can tell where the lightning strikes are.
You can tell how long it'll last, probably.
Local storm reports, duration of the storm, so many things. Weather technology, the weather. I don't know that weather forecasting. It has. Weather forecasting has really improved over the last 20 years. But I tell you what, as far as the graphics you see on television, just amazing the technological jump in the last 20 years.
So what kind of a learning curve is it for you when you get new equipment like
that? A big
that?
One, yeah. A very large learning curve.
Really? Because like when I get a new cell phone, okay, it takes me months to learn it. Okay, I can't imagine with a whole new weather system.
Yes, we use a company out of Wisconsin, they sent an installer in to set the equipment up, and then a trainer. And so all of us weather folks came in early every day for like 2 weeks with the trainer, and he's going through every aspect of the new equipment. We still have had the old equipment hooked up and using that on the air every day, but while we're doing that, we're learning the new stuff. So we put in some very, very long days for a good couple of weeks, and then when the trainer leaves, you're on your own. That's when it gets really crazy and scary.
Home alone.
Yeah, and then you get on the air that first week with the new equipment. There's just so much stress and pressure. But
don't you do any practice runs before? I mean,
well, to an extent, but there's only so much you can do. I mean, when you're practicing and you don't have any real storm scenarios out there, you have to wait till the storm event happens. And once it happens, and you have to be on the air live with it, that's when it gets really stressful. Yeah. At least for that first week or two. And we did have some active storms that first week. We actually took that system live, so it was pretty stressful, but then every day you use it after that, you get more and more comfortable with it, and now it's kind of like second nature.
And so let me ask you about the weather this week. It's Can you just give me the quick forecast and tell me when it's gonna cool down? Because 105. I mean, I can't hardly take that.
105. We're just getting started. What are you talking about?
Oh my God!
A week from tomorrow, we'll probably be 109, 110, possibly 112.
You mean a week from today?
Yes.
It'll be 110 or 112.
We started a heat wave today. Should be about 102, 103 this afternoon, and that's just the beginning.
And you're saying that in 7 days,
a week from tomorrow,
it's going to
probably be around 109, 110.
Wow.
What's happening?
And is that new weather system that told you that?
The new weather system helps me graphically show that on TV. We use forecast models and look at atmospheric thicknesses and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, it's a big bubble of very hot air coming off the Sonoran Desert, and it's expanding, and it's moving westward toward California. So.
Yeah. Maybe if I talk less on this program, heat will go down a little bit. It'll cool off.
There a little bit. You're just thinking about it.
It's hot in here. We got to turn the air on. Man, I'm getting hot thinking about it.
I know.
It's crazy.
That's what I'm talking about.
Speaking of crazy, is that guy, what's his name? I'm trying to think of his name. Some guy named Kopi. Is he still working there?
Oh yeah, Kobe's still he's an institution. He's a fixture. Gotta love my Kobe.
Yeah, and is he learning that new system too?
Oh yeah, he's part of it too. Yeah, he came to all the training sessions and he's putting it to good use on the morning show Great Day from 5 to 10 a.m. every morning. Yeah. Tune in and check out Kobe and his forecast.
Hey, so how much do you guys rely, say, on the National Weather Service? And I had, I'll ask that question after this phone. We have a phone call coming in. So go ahead, caller. You're on the air with Kevin Raymer.
Yes. Is this going to be a Nino year next year?
El Nino or La Nina?
The one means a lot of rain, we hope.
El Nino, I think.
Oh, no. It looks like the El Nino is already starting to show signs of fading out, and a La Nina is starting to pick up. So it doesn't necessarily look like a good El Nino year next year.
So what's the difference between the two?
Well, an El Nino is when you get a warm ocean current out over the eastern Pacific, and it kind of expands. And an El Nino can produce more showers and thunderstorms. And that usually means a lot more rain for California. And we did get some El Nino
means more rain?
More rain. And La Nina is a little colder water, and that usually means, for California anyway, less rain. So it looks like we had our El Nino year this year, which really helped our snowpack, but we didn't get quite as much rain as we wanted. We did early in the winter, and then it just kind of petered out real quickly there, but doesn't look good for an El Nino next year.
For 2016/17, probably not as good a rain year?
That's the thinking at this point, yes.
Oh, and that's not good. How much?
No, because we're in what we call an exceptional drought, which is the worst category. You know, after 4 years of drought, we are in the worst category, exceptional drought. After the rainfall we picked up this year with the El Nino, we came out of the exceptional into we're still into the extreme drought area, but we're in extreme drought, not exceptional drought right now, which is, we improved one category. if that makes sense.
Yeah, you know, Kevin Lenott was here from the National Weather Service not long ago, and he was telling me that we had this past year 3 inches above normal in terms of rain. That's 3 to 3.5. It was within range there.
That's where we are right now.
And you're saying we're going to get far less than that then. Not far less, but less.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying it looks like the La Nina is starting to show signs of taking over the El Nino. And if that happens, and we do get a strong La Nina, it's too early to tell yet, but if that happens, that means less rainfall generally for California.
Yeah. And it's not, you know, here's the thing. I said this in the monologue. It's not an exact science.
No.
It never has been. It's a forecast.
It's
like predicting who was going to win last night's game.
I like to try to explain to people like this. You have a pond or a small stream or something, and you throw a stick out there in the stream, and it, depending on the way it hits, and you know, and then it's going to float around, and it's going to get caught up in different currents, you know.
Yeah.
And is it going to go all the way across the stream to the other side of the bank, or is it going to go down a ways and then go over? That's the way the atmosphere is. It's almost like fluid. It's like, think about it as just a big area of air enveloping the Earth, and all those air currents are just interacting.
So you never know which
way
it's going to go.
Well, the atmosphere is never balanced. It's always trying to balance itself out. You know, you get really hot spots in parts of the of the world. So those temperature fluctuations change, cause pressure changes, and that's it. It gets very, very technical on how everything is gonna, you know, what's happening in China, you know, 2 weeks ago could be affecting our weather here in a few days or something like that, just as an analogy. It's always moving around the globe. The atmosphere is always trying to correct and balance itself, but it's always out of balance.
Yeah.
All so right. That's why it's not an exact science.
Yeah. And I don't think it ever will be. I just wish we could predict earthquakes like we do the weather, though.
Yeah.
That would be nice.
Totally different fields. I get those questions a lot. You know, is earthquakes part of the weather thing? It's really not. It's a different science.
But haven't you ever heard the
seismology
term, like, when it's like really kind of sultry and kind of overcast? Haven't you ever heard the old wives' tale? God, this feels like earthquake weather. Haven't you ever heard that?
Never heard that in my life until just
you
now.
You never have?
No.
I've heard that before.
But thanks for sharing that, because I've never heard it.
Grandparents used to say that. Boy, that's my grandmother. She used to say, man, this feels like earthquake weather.
Whatever that is.
I don't know. I'm not sure.
That's a different feel. That's seismology, yeah. Not meteorology. And so we do have, on our new weather system, we have the ability to detect when an earthquake happens, and it will give us information and make a map and show, you know, what the intensity, what the magnitude was, where it happened and all that. But
because what happens below is probably just as unstable as what's happening up above in the atmosphere,
yeah.
I'm sure.
Yeah, lots of shifting going on under the earth.
That's right. Hey, Kevin Raymer's here, meteorologist, KMPH Fox 26, 436, MeTV, option 11. Dr. Thomas Casagrande, our sponsor today here on the program. Back in just a moment with your phone calls. Got an open line.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the Samsung big screen we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy. Time for that upgrade to an HD, 3D, web-enabled Samsung TV. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise today.
Unscramble.
Sing, honey, sing.
Calling classics, calling the best. Calling favorites, we are guests. Every day there's more to come. Watch and see, there's only one.
Me.
TV.
Try me.
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 Me. Me.
Me.
That's memorable, that's me.
That's me.
Me, me, me. You gotta see. That's memorable, that's me. Me, me, me. Me, TV.
Back here on the program, 436, MeTV, option 11. Kevin Raymer is here from KMPH Fox 26. And, you know, I got a piece of videotape that I want to roll here. And it's a very young Kevin Raymer.
Oh, no. You're not doing this to me, are you?
Very young.
Well, I'm very young now.
Well, no, you're very young, but I mean, you were like a
teenager. Oh, my gosh.
Tropical Storm Fabian. Yeah, we do have a tropical storm to talk about. Don't worry. Let me just set the record straight right here and right now. This will not affect us at all. It is not going to be anywhere near South Carolina. But I want to tell you about it anyway. Tropical Storm Fabian. That's the name. It has winds of 45 miles an hour, gusting to 60 miles an hour. It's moving off to the northeast. Now, here's where Tropical Storm Fabian is. You can see it's south of Florida there, just on the western end of Cuba. It's about 120 miles south of Havana, Cuba now. We are very, very sure this is not going to be affecting the eastern seaboard. It's going to bring very, very heavy rain to Florida. As you know, Florida doesn't need all that rain. Down around the Miami area, Hollywood, Florida, just over the last couple of days, have picked up over a foot of rain. They've had serious flooding problems. They're going to see more serious flooding problems.
What happened to my hair?
I don't know.
Where did my hair go?
Well, you got married and had kids, right?
Oh, yeah. That'll make it go real quick, huh?
The kids will make it go away. The kids.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man.
Oh, yeah.
So what year was that?
From gray hair to no hair. That's what happens when you have kids. It goes gray, then it goes away.
It goes away. You're gone.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so would have been 1991 in Florence, Myrtle Beach, South Carolina area.
Myrtle Beach, there's a lot of active weather there, much more than Fresno.
Oh, yeah. You get these severe thunderstorms in the spring and early summer, and then you get throughout the summertime, just because of the heat and humidity, you get those what we call convection storms that pop up every afternoon, and then you have an occasional hurricane.
I was going to ask you, how often do you have to worry about that?
I was only in Myrtle Beach about 2 years, and the 2 years I was there, there was one hurricane that was meandering off the coast, about 100 miles off the coast, and I remember spending an entire weekend including all night long, monitoring the thing, and it never did come ashore. And the name of that hurricane now slips my mind. I'd have to look it up.
Wow.
But I never had a landfalling hurricane when I was there.
When you were there.
Yeah.
So Myrtle Beach kind of rare to get a hurricane.
Hurricane Fran did a lot of damage in that area. But that was before I got
there. Yeah, because as it comes toward land, it dissipates, right? And why is that?
What, a hurricane
Sort of. Doesn't it?
Not really, no. They continue to gain strength when they're over the open water. Once they get over land, then they're dealing with the wind. You're dealing with frictional forces against the earth, right? So that once the hurricane actually hits land, it starts immediately weakening. But it usually has its full force right as it hits.
But I thought that's what made Hurricane Katrina so unusual, is that it kept picking up steam as it was heading toward the land. But I thought when it hit land or approaching land, the closer it got to the land, it was sort of less threatening.
Depends on how large the hurricane is, too, because if you've got the outer bands and the wind around the circulation starting to interact with land, then the frictional forces are starting to weaken it a little bit.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
I see. So
the main problem with a hurricane is not necessarily even the wind; it's the storm surge. It's the water, the wall of water that comes on. You know, and that depends on the coastline. If you have a very shallow, you know, if you're coming out of the hurricane's coming out of deep ocean, and then that land is getting very shallow very quickly, the water's getting very shallow right before you hit land, then that water's piled up, and you get a bigger storm surge. Yeah.
Yeah. And so over while it's over the water, that's when it's most powerful, though, right?
Usually, yeah, generally speaking, yes.
Yeah, and you get these winds that are like well over 100 miles an hour and all that stuff. So you don't want to be out in a boat during that time.
In my Weather Channel days, this would have been back in the 1980s, we had one hurricane with 186 mile per hour winds. It's just incredible.
Out someplace in the ocean, obviously.
It was out in coming off the Atlantic, yeah.
Wow, amazing. So here's the question I've always had. Hurricanes on the East Coast, Southeast, but never any hurricanes on the West Coast. Why?
Because you have a Pacific Ocean out there, and I don't know, when's the last time you tickled your toes in the beach over there at, say, Santa Cruz or Monterey?
Maybe about a year ago.
And that water's pretty chilly, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Very cold.
Ever been to the Gulf of Mexico around Florida?
One time. And so long ago, I don't remember it.
Well, the water temperature in the Gulf of Mexico, usually by August, is like 86 degrees.
Okay.
On the Atlantic in late summer, early fall, water temperature is up in the 80s, very warm.
Atlantic Ocean is?
Yes. Hurricanes need, I'm not talking about the North Atlantic off Newfoundland. I'm talking about, say, Myrtle Beach, for instance, or down the Georgia coast.
Not off the beach in New York, though. The Atlantic can't be that warm,
Not quite that warm, but the Atlantic Ocean warms up significantly in late summer, early fall.
Okay.
Along the eastern seaboard.
All right.
Generally speaking, like from, say, North Carolina southward, especially down through Florida, you've got very, very warm water. In the Gulf of Mexico and the Caribbean, the water temperature gets to be like 86 degrees. Very conducive to hurricane development. In the Pacific, in the eastern Pacific near California, that water is getting very cold. It stays roughly, 55 degrees or so all year.
Yeah, you don't want to get in
there. in the eastern Pacific, or in the Pacific Ocean off the Mexican coast, if you're far enough south, the hurricanes will form there. But then they start moving north and northwest, and then as they start encountering colder water, as they get closer to California, it just kills them. Either it kills them or steers them. They stay with the warm water track, and they'll go off to the west, way out to sea in the shipping lanes.
Wow.
That's why we don't get hurricanes in California.
And so it's that warm air that does it on in the southeast.
It's the very warm air and the very warm water. You get more.
And so that's what causes
you get
that,
more energy
that
in
havoc.
The atmosphere because of the moisture. Yeah, and the heat. Heat and moisture. That's what hurricane development needs.
Hey, so I want you to talk about just a little bit about your career. You worked in Myrtle Beach. You worked here at KMPH, obviously, for the last 10 years. Where have you been? You started with the Weather Channel, or
I'm an Alabama boy originally. And
Crimson Tide?
Crimson Tide, Roll Tide, University of Alabama. When I my first television job was in Montgomery, Alabama. I worked at the CBS affiliate there for about a year, and then I jumped over to took a job in Pensacola, Florida, and worked there for about a year or two long ago. went out to Joplin, Missouri, worked for a station out there for a few months. I wasn't really a fan of Missouri very much. Back in those days, you know, you're single, you don't have a family to haul around, so you just pack up the U-Haul. It's easier to move around quickly.
Yeah.
So from Myrtle Beach, Joplin, Missouri, went back to Montgomery, Alabama to the number one station there. From there, I jumped to Atlanta to the National Weather Channel.
Okay.
And I did that for 6 years on air with the National Weather Channel, back when I still had hair. And then after there, let's see, where did I go? Gosh, Louisville, Kentucky. No, let's see. I left the Weather Channel and went to Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, and then from there to Louisville, Kentucky. Worked at two different stations over an 11-year span in Louisville.
Okay.
And then here I am in Fresno.
In Fresno. Yeah. So quite an illustrious career there. 30 plus years.
About 33 so far. Yeah.
33 yeah. So far. And in Missouri, you know, they have active weather too. So you just didn't like the lifestyle.
Oh well,
Missouri has all kinds of stuff going on.
Just a few years ago, Joplin, Missouri, almost got wiped off the planet because of the massive tornado outbreak. Yeah,
I remember that.
Very dangerous weather there. I was only there a few months and didn't have any real weather issues at the time that I was there. But
Such a small town.
It was very small. But you know, you're starting out in the business, and you know, you're young in the business. You go to smaller markets and small stations. I remember the wind would blow. We'd be sitting out at the pool at the apartment complex, and the wind would be blowing, and it'd still be so hot. I mean, it was the hottest wind ever. And then it seemed like just in a flash, in the matter of a couple of weeks or something, we went right into very chilly fall weather, and it'd be raining in 33 degrees.
Yeah, who could live there, right?
Did not like that at all.
Yeah. Kevin Raymer is here, KMPH Fox 26, meteorologist. You're welcome to call in at 436-ME-TV, option 11. It's on the air off the presses today. Thomas Casagrande, 2020 Optometrics, our sponsor. Back in just a moment.
Want to create something extraordinary? Create perfection. Our lifestyle appliances make it easy. KitchenAid, Ventura TV Appliance, and you, when only the best will do.
At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today.
Hey guys, finally we're getting that Friday rain we've been talking about all week. Mostly just light showers, but over the last half hour we've seen some pretty strong thunderstorms popping up. Come on over, we'll take a look, show you what's going on out here on our Doppler radar. You can see some pretty heavy thunderstorms now just off to the east of Fresno along the 180 right there, and also off to the south of Fresno between Fresno and Carruthers. Also some heavier showers and thunderstorms just northeast of Reedley. And we've had some very heavy rain up towards Shaver Lake and some lightning strikes there. And then this little area of pink and blue here, that's where the rain is changing over to snow. That's generally above 8,000 feet up in our local mountains. We've had a little rain around the TV station as well. In fact, why don't you come with me and we'll go on outside and take a look, and we'll find out what's going on out in the station parking lot right here behind KMPH. Why not? Get a bird's eye view and say hi to Gia as we go by. Hi, Gia. Hey, Rich Rodriguez. Hi, Terry, our photographer. Yeah. Let's see. We'll go on out through the big doors. We'll get to the outside and see what's going on out here. Oh yeah, a little bit of a mix of sun and mostly overcast and a little bit of light rain going on as well. Not the big thunderstorms right here at the station. We did hear a rumble of thunder about 5 minutes ago, but we are getting that needed rainfall, and it looks like some areas are going to pick up to a quarter of an inch of rain. So that certainly is some really good news.
All right. That obviously wasn't taken recently, but that was a live Facebook
feed,
right?
Yeah, social media is a big deal now, as we all know, right? Yeah. So we have a person that is responsible for a lot of the social media stuff, a full-time job just doing social media. So that was during an active weather situation, and the social media guy came over and said, let's do a live Facebook feed, and he went a little behind the scenes and go outside. And so we were actually doing that live on the internet.
Yeah.
That wasn't live on TV at that moment, but it was live on the internet.
Live on the internet. All right, caller, you're on with Kevin Raymer. Go ahead.
Yeah, my question is does he think that, television, do they still put as much emphasis on credentials and as much as they do, I guess, now on looks as for the weatherman or weatherwoman?
If it was based on look, I probably wouldn't have a job. Especially after I lost all my hair. It's a visual medium. You know, we're expected to dress appropriately and, you know, professionally. No, you don't have to be a glamour queen necessarily to be on. Credentials are important. You know, I have AMS certification, and they want to know that I know what I'm talking about when I'm talking about it. I suppose.
Any other questions, caller?
No, that was it. You know, just wondering because, you know, I mean, all the other people I see on TV are really handsome, young, and I just, you know, I mean, but I like the, you know, John 26.
Well, what are you trying to say about Kevin? He's not handsome.
No, that's what I'm saying. I want my weatherman to be somebody I can identify with. I can say, you know
right,
what?
Right. Yes. Know?
Yeah. Okay.
You can identify with Kevin. We can all identify with you.
Well, sure.
Great personality, Kopey. And speaking of Kopey, he goes out and does all these school visits, and you've done that too, right?
Yeah. A program called Kev's Class. And basically, I go out and do a one-hour weather program, generally for third, fourth, and fifth graders. I have a Van de Graaff generator, which is a little machine that I take with me that makes lightning. I call it my baby lightning machine, and kind of explain how lightning works and thunderstorms, and do a little couple experiments with the kids. They like that, and we talk about weather and the water cycle. And so hopefully to getting that back up and going again in the fall when school resumes.
All right. Yeah. Caller, you're on the air with Kevin Raymer. Go ahead.
Yes, I'd like to find out how could the like the old Farmer's Almanac and them come up with the weather predictions like a year ahead of time?
That's a great question.
That is a really great question. I'm not real
Farmer's Almanac.
I'm not really up on the Farmer's Almanac too much. I've looked at it a little bit here and there. I don't know if they use climatological data, like from records from a long time or not. Or I'm not really. You
is
know,
it usually accurate?
Depends on who you ask.
Pretty darn close.
Go ahead, caller. Keep her up there. Caller?
Yeah. Farmer's Almanac. Because I get it every year, and they are usually pretty close on what's happening and stuff. As a matter of fact, when we've had our rains and things like that, I usually circle the dates and what have you on the almanac, and it's usually pretty close.
You know, I kind of agree. I mean, I've seen cases where it was pretty accurate, and that's a great question. I need to probably investigate because I'm not really a Farmer Almanac person, but need to figure out where they're getting their information. I remember one year. This would have been in the 90s. I was working in Louisville, Kentucky, and it was a beautiful fall. I mean, just gorgeous sunshine, and I would be out riding my bike every day in the afternoon after work. And there were so many squirrels everywhere, just squirrels all over the place. And I noticed that they seemed to be extra fluffy and extra large and extra busy gathering, you know, the acorns and stuff. Yeah, and the Farmer's Almanac was saying because of the activity with some of the animals, like the squirrels, like that, they were predicting to be a very severe winter, and that was the most severe winter ever on history for the Louisville, Kentucky area.
There was something to that.
Yeah.
Let me ask the caller. Are you still there? I need to ask you a question. Yeah. Now you say you get the Farmer's Almanac all the time. Did the Farmer's Almanac predict this all this rain that we had this past year with El Nino and all that?
Yes, it did.
It did. What did it say?
It was just saying that. We were going to have an extra heavy rain and stuff through the winter time, and they was showed extra days and stuff in the Farmer's Almanac and what have you, even up through and into June, which I thought, you know, normally in California we don't get that, but we sure did.
Yeah, I wonder if they have, meteorologist working for the Farmer's Almanac. I don't know. You've piqued my curiosity, though. I'm going to find out about that because that's interesting.
I'm an old farm girl from the word go. And my husband and I used to raise horses and cattle and stuff. Mm-hmm. And we would watch the animals in the fall of the year. And when they would get an extra heavy coat, we knew we was in for a worse winter.
That's what happened with the squirrels in Louisville, Kentucky in that January. The temperature went to 22 below zero. We had 16 inches of snow overnight, 22 below zero with a wind chill of 44 below. That's unprecedented in Louisville, Kentucky. And that happened. That was that same winter following that fall where the squirrels were so active and so extra bushy. They had extra coat.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's something to that. Yeah.
All right. And let me ask you one other question, caller. Where do you get your Farmer's Almanac? Is it mailed to you or what?
No, I pick mine up in the stores, usually in the magazine racks and stuff like that in the stores.
Yeah, okay.
Well, you certainly piqued my curiosity. I'm going to find out how they get their forecast together, because that'd be interesting to know.
Yeah.
Because I've never really thought much about the Farmer's Almanac, but you're right. I mean, you know,
a lot of people rely on it.
It brings to mind that instance in Louisville when the animals were very active and extra coat
cold. You know, they give you predictions on when to plant your above ground crops and your below ground crops and this kind of stuff. And I went by it strictly this year, and I've got tomatoes coming out my ears.
Okay. Well, we thank you for the call, ma'am. I appreciate it. Got to go.
Thank
a break.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you for watching. Thanks for calling. 436 MeTV Option 11. You're welcome to call in and weigh in with Kevin Raymer today at KMPH Fox 26. Dr. Thomas Casagrande, our sponsor today here on the program. Back in a moment.
The following is another list of things you will not hear on MeTV programs. Man cave, baby bump, whatevs, double half calf mochaccino, faux hawk, redonkulous, totes adorbs, hella, holla, YOLO, cray cray, and MeTV is still Kardashian free. This is what you will hear on MeTV programs.
Welcome, Denim. The Twilight Zone.
About wolves.
I object, Your Honor.
Mr. Grant.
I hear you right.
You heard me right.
MeTV. Thanks for listening.
The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance. Enjoy generous-sized cooktops and sauté or simmer with ease, while true convection ovens offer even baking and juicy roasting perfection. Foods stay their freshest in spacious refrigerators with convenient controls and clear filtered ice and water. Easy-to-clean surfaces reduce fingerprints, and the quietest of dishwashers makes cleanup a snap. The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance.
Beautiful day on tap for tomorrow. Really,
you should
nice.
Have drawn like a sunshine right there.
Well, I put red on there. Next time you do
time
it.
Time was of the essence.
here's our 10-day forecast. 10-day forecast Wednesday. It's going to be hard to see here. Help me out here, Chris.
High to low 80s.
No, 78 on Wednesday tomorrow. 55 the low. 82 warming up a little bit on Thursday. Friday will be 75. We'll go back down again Friday into the weekend. Look at Saturday. Sunny and 75, 72 on Sunday. We do have a 20% chance of rain on Monday.
This is awesome. Can you do this every night, Kevin?
I'd rather not.
And again, this is because we have a transformer blow in the area, so obviously everything is a little...
Computers are not
right now.
Engineers are feverishly working on it.
But that was fantastic.
The newscast must go on. Engineers are feverishly working on the weather computer. We hope to have that back up soon.
Otherwise, Kevin will be drawing more.
That's right. We'll be right back.
You know, even during the power outage, you got to get creative sometimes.
You got to do what you got to do.
Yeah.
You know?
And so, the show must go on.
All of our weather computers went down with that outage, so they're like, I guess we just won't have weather. And I'm like, no, there's some...
No, let's make up
a... There's a poster board in the back. Give me a marker.
Yeah, give me a...
You know, so whatever.
Remember during the elections years ago, about 20 years ago, Tim Russert came up with that board?
Oh,
that's
yeah.
what that reminds me
exactly,
of.
Exactly.
During the elections. Yeah, years
go
ago.
Go back to the old school. When you
that's
have
exactly right. Get creative. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Well, I love all that hair. That is true. But you're still plenty good looking there.
Thank you, man.
Wow.
Very much.
There you go, Kevin.
I want to know one thing there. How do you ever watch the videos on the internet about HAARP and how it affects the weather? And have you noticed any changes yourself?
I haven't seen a lot of videos on it, but I do listen to some national radio shows that talk about that kind of thing all the time. I think the jury's still out on it. I'm not sure where I stand on that. I hear some very interesting theories, but I don't really have any actual proof yet. You know, they're talking chemtrails and things like that. And I don't know. It's kind of out of my field of my realm of knowledge there. But I find it interesting that people are talking about it. And there are some people very convinced that there are folks out there altering the weather by altering the atmosphere. But
we don't know. It's a theory. So any other questions for Kevin?
No. I do notice one thing about men. I don't know why this is. You guys lose your hair, but your head gets bigger. Why is that?
Maybe
my head's always been big, so I
maybe
my
you
only
just
problem.
Maybe you could just see it better. The hair's not covering it up anymore or something. I don't know. I don't know.
All right, guys. Take care.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, I lost all this weight, and my head's still big. I don't know why.
There you go.
I don't know. You were on a weight loss program for a little while, and...
Didn't work out too well, but I finally took the surgery route. So now
you did?
I'm down about 135 pounds now. Yeah.
Wow. So tell us about that. When did this take place?
Oh, probably a couple years ago now. A couple summers ago. Gastric sleeve, it's where they go in laparoscopically and they actually take the stomach pouch, and which is like at the time was the size of a basketball, I guess, and then they bring it down to like the size of a banana. So you eat very small meals throughout the day. But it worked. I'm down 135 pounds, and you know I can walk around the block now and jog and play racquetball.
They reduce the size of your stomach.
Yeah, that's what they do.
And so you'll eat less.
Yeah, because you fill up really quickly. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you just and it kills your hunger too. I mean, you know, you think, oh well, I'm gonna miss having that giant steak. No, not really. You have a couple bites and you're totally fine. You feel good.
Yeah, did you change your diet at all? Or?
You have to in the beginning because, you know, for the healing process, you have to really eat bland, soft, non-spicy food. But over time, you know, you can get back to eating pretty normal stuff, just smaller
amounts.
But
you're not, you didn't go the vegetarian route or that. You can't do that, I guess.
No, but tried it on my own many times to lose it and just get to the point where you couldn't lose it anymore, so went surgery.
Yeah, did you get on Jenny Craig or any of those?
No,
highly advertised.
Never tried any of those.
Yeah, I didn't. Really
well, not lately. I think I tried Nutrisystem or something like that years ago. But I'm sure it's a great program. I probably just didn't follow it correctly.
Here's the thing: everybody's metabolism is different. It's everybody's different, body type is different. Everybody's reacts differently to certain foods.
And the thing too is, once you get, coming from being 135 pounds heavier, I'm still a big guy. I'm not some little guy.
How
here.
Tall are you?
I'm 6'2".
Okay.
But you know, even after 135 pound loss, I think back to when I was 135 pounds heavier, and everybody's like, just got to get out there and exercise. When you're that heavy, your back hurts, your knees hurt, everything hurts.
Feet hurt.
You can't really exercise that hard. I mean, your actual size, it interferes with your working out. So
the actual size prevents you from getting that necessary workout.
And the bottom line is, and I have talked to enough people and kind of realized this over time too, it's more about the nutrition and how many calories you're taking in. That's primarily drives your weight, not as much as the exercise. Exercise is very important, can keep you healthy, but that's not necessarily in and of itself.
No, but the exercise, you're burning calories. So if you're taking less in,
it does help.
Then if more is going out than what's coming in, that's the key.
Yeah, but if you work out really, really hard and it just makes you hungrier and you eat a little bit more, then you're
defeating the purpose.
You're defeating the purpose, yes.
Yeah. All right. Let's go to break. 436 MeTV, option 11. Kevin Raymer is here from KMPH Fox 26. And your phone calls are more than welcome. We've got an open line here. Thomas Casagrande, our sponsor on the program today. Back in a moment. At 2020 Optometric, your vision is their focus. Whether you're 5 or 65, Dr. Thomas Casagrande will get to know you, your lifestyle, and vision needs to ensure that your contacts or eyeglasses are a perfect fit and the right prescription every time. With the Valley's largest selection of eyewear, 2020 has over 2,000 frames, including top designer brands like Coach, Tiffany, Prada, Ray-Ban, Oakley, and more. Eye exams start as low as $89, so call or stop by to schedule your appointment today.
Not sure what you're watching? want to see what's coming up next? Or just want to browse what's on without the hassle of flipping channels? Your wish has come true. Now you can view schedules for all the digital TV channels available in the Central Valley. Get local weather updates and forecasts, and listen to nationally syndicated Biz Talk Radio, all on KVHF 4.1. Rescan your TV now, then tune in to digital channel 4.1 to start enjoying the all-new TV guide.
Back here on Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. It's on the air, off the presses, here on Connect With Me. And Kevin, what do you enjoy most about your job? You've obviously done this for 30 years. Weather here in Fresno, you've been here 10. Right. You know, the weather doesn't change much here. It's rain, and then and it's then hot.
6 or 7 months of dry heat.
It's hot. How do you make the forecast? Like this, in the next couple of weeks, how are you going to make this forecast interesting?
That's the thing,
It's hot.
I run into people all the time, like at the grocery store or at the gas station or something, and they're like, you got the easiest job in the world. I can be a weatherman around here. It's just going to be sunny and hot. But your bosses and your viewers, you know, they expect to hear the weather story, and they want to see a good a good presentation. They want to. So my challenge is to try to make it interesting, even though it's the same thing for a month or two or three on end. You've still got to be able to tell the story, and you need to tell it creatively and with a good good graphics. You know, it needs to look good on the air. So it actually makes the job a little more difficult. When there's a lot of weather going on, my job's actually easier.
So you're looking at making the forecast at least creative.
And try to explain what's happening.
Why is it getting so hot?
Yeah, exactly.
It's kind of like telling a story, an interesting story. And here it is with some fancy graphics.
And you have to make the pictures. You have to build those graphics and build those maps and use those computers to do that. So when the weather gets to be kind of dog days of summer, actually it gets more challenging to come up with interesting and new ways to tell the story, you know, in the graphics. When there's a lot of weather going on, lots of storms, you let the radar do the talking.
Talk about your responsibilities too, because you got social media that the station is heavy duty on. You're talking about Twitter and Facebook, the usual suspects, and then you've got the Omaha station. You do the weather there. Explain how that works.
Well, KMPH Fox 26 is owned by Sinclair Broadcasting.
For a number of years now.
At least a couple, I think, lately. We were purchased by Sinclair Broadcasting Corporation, and that's a national company.
National chain.
I think it's about a $227 billion corporation. They have TV stations all over the country, and one of our sister stations is out of Omaha, Nebraska. So it's my job to do the forecasting for Omaha as well. So I have to build the weather graphics for the Omaha newscast.
They have different type of weather than we do.
Very, very different. Very severe. So even in the summer, this time of year, it's very quiet and hot around here. Tomorrow is probably going to be a severe weather day for Omaha, and I'll be quite busy.
What are you talking about over there? What's happening over there that's severe?
Severe thunderstorms and or tornadoes this time of year.
Okay.
You know, May, June, early July for Omaha. So, when I come in every day to work, I don't, immediately start working on Fresno. I also have responsibilities to do Omaha and do those graphics and get that newscast ready. We actually do the, because of technology these days, we can pretty much do a broadcast from anywhere. So we use our studio in Fresno and actually do a live. It's their 9 o'clock news in Omaha, Nebraska. We're on the air live at 9 o'clock, 9 p.m. in Omaha. That's 7 o'clock here. So we go on air and do a live broadcast out of our studio at 7 p.m. every night.
It's 7 o'clock every night.
Every night, Monday through Friday, and then again on Sunday night they have
a full blown newscast, right?
Full blown 1 hour newscast every night for Omaha, Nebraska.
Okay.
We use our anchors here. There are reporters in the field there in Omaha.
Oh, okay.
But we have our anchors here and, talk back and forth and everything. They have electronic backpacks now, kind of new technology, so they can go live in the field and we can be live here in the studio. And so we put together a full-fledged newscast for Omaha, Nebraska. And then when that newscast is over, then start focusing on getting ready for the
10 o'clock news
here in Fresno. Yeah.
Yeah. And so... I guess you have to keep up social media for both places, right?
Right.
Omaha and, Fresno.
Right. They all, both stations have their Facebook pages. We have to update Facebook, and we try to be active on Twitter and connect with the viewers and Instagram and Snapchat, and there's a lot of them.
I'm not on any of that. Well, I'm on Facebook, and sometimes I get on Twitter, but not.
Well,
not
social media
Snapchat is
social media is becoming extremely important now because the, you know, the with all the new technology and all the new social media, and you've got younger and younger people using social media, it kind of complements TV. TV complements the social media aspect. It gives viewers a way to interact. You know, we could be in the middle of a live newscast. In the old days, before social media, you wouldn't know what the viewers were thinking. Now they're sending you tweets and Facebooking and, you know, whatever, and can ask questions during the commercial breaks, and our anchors will respond, you know, and so it kind of opens up a dialogue, modern day dialogue between the viewer and the people in the TV station.
So do you have weather spotters, like, up in the mountains during the winter? So how does that work? Is it through social media, or do they call you on the phone? Like,
both.
The old-fashioned way.
Both. They'll call you on the phone. They'll get on Facebook. We oftentimes, every time there's an event, big event, news event or weather event, we'll say, you know, if you have photos, send them in, you know, to our news desk. And the photos come in, and we like to put them on the air. So it
gets, do they come in through Facebook or Twitter or both?
Both.
Both. And we got a phone call here. All right. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air with Kevin Raymer.
Hey, Kevin, I'm going to ask you a quick question. How do the media over there in Omaha compare to here in the Valley as far as the way they treat their police department? You know, because that's all you hear in the media is how the police departments have treated individuals. It doesn't make a difference what category, whatever. But how do they treat them there differently? I know in Omaha there's more tornadoes and whatnot, but the difference between there, the media, and the way it is in the Valley, I kind of question to see, or I just want to get an answer, because you'd be the one to really know what goes on with media, with police department. That's really what I wanted to know.
Not really sure I completely understand the question. Something about
I'm not sure either, but just to clarify, you know, Kevin doesn't do the news. He's not a news reporter or a news anchor, so he doesn't go out and cover news events unless it's related to weather. And a lot of times you do lead the newscast with a weather segment.
Weather becomes news.
Weather is news.
Weather is news.
It's news all the time.
Yeah, but it sometimes takes precedence, becomes the top news story. Weather does.
So you're not out covering crime stories. You're not out talking to the police department. So you're not fully aware of that. So just to clarify, Kevin is the meteorologist at KMPH Fox 26. In charge of the weather department. He is the bureau chief. That's an old term. That's an old broadcasting term. The bureau chief here at KMPH in Fresno. So, you know, with all the social media, how relevant, and I talked about this in the monologue, is local weather today? Do people still tune in to see the weather? Because back in my day, when I first started, my old news director used to say, you know, John, you're doing sports, but I hate to tell you this. According to our latest research, and it's right here in front of me, John, people don't care about local sports. They care about weather.
Weather is still very, very important to our viewers, and we take it very seriously. But, weather's a big part of our newscast every night. The difference, I think, now is folks have their phones, and they can go, I already know what the 7-day or the 10-day forecast is. I just see it on my phone. But I think they still want to connect with a real person that knows.
Where's that information coming from on my phone? Where, the National Weather Service?
Well, there's so many different, we call them vendors now. There are companies out there, so many different companies. One company will have a forecasting department and forecasters that work for that company, and they'll supply the information for that particular phone.
Yeah.
Different brand of phone may have a different
vendor,
you know, forecast. So it comes from a lot of different sources. There's a lot of weather companies out there now. But I think the research shows us now, some of the latest research in, is that people still want to connect with a real person that has a good handle on the local forecast, and they want to hear more about the science of it. You know, you can't get the science of why it's happening on the phone, but you can from a person that is a meteorologist.
Yeah, it's funny because you know, about a week or two ago, I took my son to a Giants game, and we were scurrying out the door, early Saturday morning, and I said, quick, look on your phone, see what the weather's going to be like in San Francisco.
Yep, absolutely,
okay?
Yeah.
Need to know if I need a coat or not.
Exactly,
okay? And
yes.
So it's so easy now.
Yeah, weather,
it's just
weather
so
is every,
easy.
Weather is everywhere. It's on your mobile apps. It's on all your phones. It's on the internet. There's so many companies out there. But I think people still want to connect with a local person that lives in the community, that knows what, you know, the, there are different nuances of weather around here in different times of the year. You know, we microclimates. There are things that you can't get from your phone, you know, and you can't necessarily always get you can't get the science from your phone of why this is happening and how long it's going to last. You might look on your phone and say, oh, it's going to be 105 triple digits for the next few days. But why and how long is this going to last? You know, I mean, I can tell you how many more days beyond what your phone is telling you.
Can you tell me the next 2 weeks?
Pretty much. We are in the middle of a heat. Well, we just began a heat wave today.
No, but you told me, I mean, a week from today, it's going to be like 110,
yeah,
maybe,
we should see,
112?
We should see about 103 today, 102, 103. It looks like a week from tomorrow, we're talking triple-digit heat all the way up until next Tuesday when it could be 109, 110.
That's crazy. You know, my first day was August the 8th, 1996, here in the city of Fresno. First day, okay?
It was hot.
Driving in from Sacramento, it was 113 degrees. My car broke down along Highway 99. I finally got to Fresno, and I said, what am I doing here?
Yeah, a little bit cooler in Sacramento, wasn't it?
It is, but, you know, I mean, 113 is outrageous.
But it's a dry heat, John.
I know, but Kevin, I mean, so is Phoenix. Do you want to live there?
Not really, no. No, but yes, we get that heat. And right now we've got this big high-pressure cell coming out of the Sonoran Desert, and it's just a big bubble of super hot air, and it's expanding and compressing, and it's just going to get really hot around here real quick.
Did you say the same thing to yourself when you first came to Fresno? Like, what am I doing here?
Yeah, I remember, I guess I went into shock when I saw my first power bill in July. The first July I was here.
Yeah,
because, you know, I mean, compared to what I was paying back east for electricity, it was
damn near nothing. All right, let's take this call real quick. We got some time here. Caller, we're kind of short on time, but go ahead and fire that question out there.
Question, John, to Kevin. You know, each station, do you find yourself being competitive to each other stations in Fresno?
Ooh, good
and
one.
That's my question.
Yeah.
Kevin.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that call. I appreciate it.
Yes, very much.
Another Kevin in town doing weather.
Yeah, I know.
We don't want to mention the station, do we?
No, we don't. Every station, I mean, we want to provide the best service for our viewers, but it is a business, you know, and you're trying to get viewers, and that's all part of the ratings thing. So yeah, it is very competitive.
Quickly, in 30 seconds, when you got the other stations doing a 5 o'clock weather, and then you come on at 10, do you try to make it different than what people may have already seen?
Yeah.
To a certain extent, or you don't worry about it.
I used to fall years ago. I kind of fell into the trap of what did the other guys say across town, and I would watch their stuff. But then I found that it kind of influenced me, and I'm like, I don't want to be influenced by that. I want to do my own thing. I want to do my own forecasting. I might go back and watch something they did after the fact, after my newscast, but I don't want to be influenced
by what they say.
I have the confidence that I know what I'm doing, and I can forecast. You know, do my forecasting and my graphics, and we're very competitive, but I don't like try to watch the other guys to see what it doesn't influence what I'm going to do.
Long time ago, when I was doing sports, I mean, talking 30 years ago, I used to do the same thing. I used to not watch the other stations because I didn't want to be influenced.
Because sometimes they can lead you in the wrong direction. You know, you may have picked up on something that they didn't pick up on, and then you go the other way.
Got to go. Don't want to get cut off. You know how that goes.
It's been fun.
Come back again.
Okay.
Yeah, sooner next time. All right. Kevin Raymer, meteorologist, KMPH Fox 26, Monday through Friday at 10 o'clock. Watch him every day, my friends. He gets the forecast right. See you tomorrow with Sam Shima. Have a good day.
If you have a need to promote your business or event, please consider MeTV Fresno for your next campaign. MeTV reaches over 100,000 of your potential customers in the Fresno area every single week. Plus, you can rest assured that your commercial is running in the greatest family-friendly programs of all time. MeTV Fresno delivers a strong, loyal audience ready to buy, and your campaign will cost a fraction of what you're paying for your advertising now. Call me today to find out how affordable MeTV is at 905-1925. Giddy up.